National Academy of Future Physicians. My name is Charlotte Starling. I attended the 2014 Congress of Future Medical Leaders in February and had the most amazing time. To say the least, I was inspired. In an effort to utilize that adrenaline and excitement instilled in me after the Congress, I actually started this project on the plane ride home from Washington, D.C. on February 17th. Thank you to all of you for hosting the Congress. I had an amazing time. And I would also like to thank you in advance for your consideration. For the scholarship challenge, I have identified and would like to bring to your attention the international issue of HIV transmission during latency. So what is HIV-1? HIV stands for Human Immunodeficiency Virus Type 1. The virus attacks the immune system, specifically CD4 T lymphocytes, ultimately resulting in a depleted or compromised immune system. One's immune system would normally be the first responder in the fight against viruses, bacteria, fungi, or other pathogens. However, when one is infected with HIV, the immune system fails to fight against external pathogens efficiently, causing the individual to be critically ill with something as harmless as a mild common cold or an outer ear infection. Instead of fighting external pathogens, the immune system does not have the strength to respond appropriately. Transmission of HIV occurs easily through unprotected sex, bodily fluid exchange, blood transfusions, drug use as in sharing needles, and or mother to child, whether that be through birth or through breastfeeding. During breastfeeding, some of the viral RNA or some of the antigen-presenting CD4 cells may carry over into the newborn. Although a devastating disease, HIV is one of the most intricate and amazingly engineered molecules known to man. When the HIV virus enters into the blood, it fuses with CD4 T lymphocytes of the immune system, then releases its contents, including the viral RNA and proteins, into the host CD4 T cell cytoplasm. It then uses CD4 T cell's major histocompatibility complex, or MHC. MHC of a cell is what defines it as a host cell. It's like a name tag that says, "Hey, other immune cells, I belong here. No need to attack me." So when the HIV virus uses the MHC of the CD4 T cells, it can replicate and amplify undetected. Reverse transcriptase, one of the key proteins in retroviral replication, turns retroviral RNA into DNA, which is opposite of normal replication. The reverse increases the chance of mutations occurring. Herein lies another obstacle to HIV detection. Because of increased chance of mutations, the virus is always changing, thus making a highly specific test is a very difficult task. Integrase, another vital protein in viral replication, integrates the viral RNA into host DNA. That recombinant DNA is then replicated. It's through this method that the virus is amplified within the host CD4 T cells. Protease also plays an important role by cutting longer peptide chains into smaller peptide chains so that the virus can be amplified more and exported to infect other CD4 T cells. As you can see, the engineering behind this HIV molecule is what makes it so successful as a virus. So here's the issue within the overarching issue of HIV. HIV latency, which is the period of time between infection and when symptoms develop, is an asymptomatic period. When someone is asymptomatic, as in the latency period, they do not feel inclined to get tested in the clinic, nor do they feel inclined to seek any kind of medical care. But within the 8 weeks of clinical latency, individuals who have been infected are participating in risk behaviors and thus unknowingly transmit the virus to other unknowing individuals. The cycle continues with the highest rates of transmission occurring in the weeks following infection or during the clinical latency stage. During that 8 week clinical latency period, the virus continues to replicate undetected by the immune system and undetected by the asymptomatic individual. In other words, the issue, simplified, is that HIV is being transmitted during the latency period unknowingly. These second and third points address the issue that people are constantly unaware of their HIV statuses because if they are asymptomatic, they are not inclined to seek medical attention or go to clinic to be tested. The general solution to the issue of HIV transmission during latency is to develop a home HIV qualitative screening test that uses highly advanced and new technologies that not only increase sensitivity and specificity, but also allow the individual to test themselves frequently. Before I jump into proposing a solution to the issue of HIV transmission during latency, I'd like to run through a few issues with current screening and diagnostic HIV tests. A general obstacle in HIV detection is the behavior and ratios of CD4 and CD8 T cells. Initially, as you can see at these first two points, the baseline cell count for CD4 T cells is about 1,325 cells per milliliter cubed of blood, while the baseline cell count for CD8 T cells is about 1,987.5 cells per milliliter cubed of blood. So the baseline ratios of CD4 T cells to CD8 T cells in healthy individuals or those that have been recently infected is about 0.667. However, approximately 1 week after infection, that ratio changes dramatically. At 1 week post-infection, the CD4 T cell count decreases to 1,076.56 cells per milliliter cubed of blood, and CD8 T cell count increases to 11,428.25 cells per milliliter cubed of blood. By the end of 4 weeks, the CD4 T cell count decreases fourfold, while the CD8 T cell count increases 20-fold. The reasoning behind this is that after about the second week of infection, CD8 T cells start to attack antigen-presenting CD4 T cells, thus causing a significant decrease in the CD4 T cells and a sharp increase in the CD8 T cells. So how is this a limitation of HIV screening tests? Well, CD4 T cells, the cells that are normally being detected in HIV screening tests, are already minimal in concentration. However, the cell count continues to decrease rapidly during the weeks following infection. From the data presented here, we can conclude that the best time to detect HIV, if aiming to detect CD4 antigen-presenting T cells, is best to detect the antigen-presenting CD4 T cells after about 1 week of infection. That 1 week will allow the HIV pathogen to travel from the outside of the body into the lymphatic fluid and then finally into the blood. In both the lymph and the blood, the virus is able to begin replicating in CD4 cells and then making those cells dysfunctional. The viral P24 antigen assay is a very popular test used to detect the HIV intracellular antigen P24, coded for by the GAG gene. P24 is the protein that composes the capsid within the virus that protects its retroviral RNA and proteins. There are a few issues with this test, the first being that it must be performed in a healthcare setting with an invasive blood draw. With recently infected individuals being asymptomatic, it is not likely that people will feel inclined to go into a healthcare setting to be tested for the presence of P24 antigen in their blood. Another issue that is a huge flaw in the test is that anti-P24 antibodies are the very first to develop. These antibodies attack the P24 protein, causing varying levels of it in the host's blood. The levels of P24, although detectable to a certain extent, are so low after the significant anti-P24 antibody attack that the P24 antigen assay is only 50% sensitive in asymptomatic patients, which is the majority of infected individuals during the latency period. The viral load test aims to detect the viral load, which is the viral RNA in whole blood. As with the P24 antigen assay, there are flaws in this test as well. The first issue is that it requires an invasive blood draw in a healthcare setting. This is an issue because, as I said earlier, people who are asymptomatic are not inclined to seek medical attention or go to a clinic to be tested for HIV. To explain the second flaw in the test, I will address a study presented by the Oxford Journals. In the study, shedding patterns of viral RNA were observed over a 10-week period. Viral load levels ranged from 0 to 3.6 million across 10 time intervals or weeks. The lower bound for viral load detection is greater than 20 to 49 RNA copies per milliliter of blood. However, if during some weeks the viral load is 0 and others is 3.6 million, then the test will give false negatives if the viral load is less than 50 viral RNA copies. But what if I told you there was a solution to the issue of HIV transmission during latency that would reduce transmission rates significantly? The RT-1 Qualitative Screening Test. After identifying the flaws in current HIV screening tests, I thought I should make my own test that aims to inform individuals of their HIV status constantly in a home setting. Informing individuals of their HIV status constantly will allow them to take the proper precautions to ensure minimal transmission amongst others. Aim 1 of the RT-1 qualitative screening test is to identify HIV-1 antigens RET and TAT. These two antigens are intracellular within the P24 capsid. RET, the first antigen, supports RNA export from the nucleus to the cytoplasm through the Rheb response element pathway. TAT, the next protein, increases transcription of viral RNA through positive feedback. Out of the 9 genes, you may be wondering why Rheb and TAT. Well, first of all, the Rheb and TAT antigens are intracellular within the capsid and thus are less accessible to the anti-Rheb and anti-TAT antibodies. Without significant antibody attacks, these viral antigens can amplify into levels that are detectable early on during latency. Aim 2 of the RT-1 Qualitative Screening Test is to use a combination of two highly sensitive and versatile substances to bind to and label the two antigens of interest. The first is 17AA arginine-rich RNA binding motif. This peptide has very high affinity for both TAT and Rheb. This idea of using multiple antigens is a novel idea and will increase the sensitivity of RT1. The peptide antigen binding will then be labeled by multi-walled carbon nanotubes. The multi-walled carbon nanotubes are hollow and cylindrical, and each layer has a different carbon interface, whether that be zigzag, armchair, or chiral. The differing sizes and shapes of the nanotube layers makes them excellent semiconductors in the presence of proteins, which is a fundamental aspect of RT1 qualitative screening test. So now imagine the strip of carbon nanotubes like a diabetes test strip. Then imagine that strip being coated with 17AA arginine-rich RNA binding motif. The TAT and Rheb intracellular HIV antigens will bind to the 17AA arginine-rich RNA binding motif, and then that binding will be labeled through an electrical impulse conducted by the multi-walled carbon nanotubes, and that electrical impulse will then be measured by a meter. As you can see from this diagram, our goal is HIV detection. The antigens we hope to detect are TAT and Rheb. Through gene ontology, we can determine that these genes are intracellular and promote viral RNA export and transcription. Then we move over to the left, and we can see here that arginine-rich RNA binding motif and multi-walled carbon nanotubes will allow us to detect the antigens of interest, but the combination of both is optimal for maximum sensitivity while giving the fastest response. Aim 3, the last aim of the RT1 qualitative screening test, is to make it cost-effective. Although carbon nanotubes in general may be expensive, there are ways in which we can make the test strips less expensive. While we are unsure of the volume, length, and width that the test strip must be in order to work properly and conduct electrical impulses when proteins bind, we can cut the test strips lengthwise, making them thinner, or making them shorter to reduce the amount of nanotubes and arginine-rich RNA binding motif needed per millimeter cubed. Another fundamental aspect to the RT1 is that parts of the kit are reusable. Using the diabetes glucose testing as an example again, the meter that measures the electrical impulses can be reused for years. However, the test strips must be replaced after use, but can be sold in stores separately. In conclusion, the RT1 qualitative screening test will be able to detect the HIV-1 specific intracellular antigens Rheb and TAT, because the test is designed in a way that counteracts the flaws of pre-existing tests. The combination of 17AA arginine-rich RNA binding motif and multi-walled carbon nanotubes is optimal for maximum sensitivity and specificity. Lastly, a home test will allow individuals in both developing and developed areas to test themselves in a psychologically safe environment, as they may be embarrassed or scared to go in and get tested. The home test will also allow individuals to test themselves on a regular basis, informing them of their HIV statuses so that they may take the proper precautions to ensure minimal transmission. Now, of course, this scholarship challenge was exciting and allowed me to learn a lot about the HIV pathogen, the issue of transmission, and the topic of healthcare in both developed and developing countries. It's not enough. I'm planning to pursue my research this summer. Here's a very general timeline. First, I'm hoping to achieve AIM-1 by researching the properties of Rheb and TAT in CD4 cells. I've already begun this process by reading the gene ontology and several papers about both TAT and Rheb antigens. My next goal is to research and test the properties of multi-walled carbon nanotubes and the 17AA arginine-rich RNA binding motif, and then the combination of both to verify that the semiconductor properties of the nanotubes and the peptide binding from the 17AA arginine-rich RNA binding motif are still viable. The last step in my process will be to create a working prototype with high sensitivity and specificity that is cost-effective. Now, where will I be conducting this research? I was granted some lab space at UCLA over the summer. Although the planning and funding is still being worked out, I'm very much looking forward to working in a bioengineering lab on my own project. Lastly, to the person who continues to inspire me, Jack Andrepa. Thank you, Jack, for being a constant source of inspiration to me. Your use of nanotechnology is what inspired me to use the nanotubes in my own test. You're a scientist, an educator, but also a student, and it's your motivation and drive that keeps me dedicated to my own project. Thank you. As Jack Andrepa said, dream big and then make it happen. Well, National Academy future positions, I've dreamt big, and now I'm going to make it happen.